of the Holy Spirit be with you all. We open our hearts to the same grace and forgiveness which accompanied Our Lady from the first moment of her conception to her assumption into heaven. We invite that love and forgiveness in our hearts.
They took Jeremiah and cast him into the system of Achaia, the king. sent to the Hebrews. Brethren, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood. The word of the Lord.
Thanks.
And only later, over time,
She was going to be judged as a bad woman until things sorted themselves out. And imagine then when she proudly, as a young mother, brings that child to the temple and hears the words of Simeon, that her heart will be pierced with a sword. That she, as mother, would not only rejoice to have the child in her arms, rejoice to have the nurturing of that child, but later in life would have to hold his lifeless body and mourn and weep for what could have been and what was lost. These difficulties and these upheavals were intrinsic to the life of Mary, as they are intrinsic to our lives. Upheavals and divisions that now and then shake the very foundations of our own faith in God. And at the same time, there is the comfort and the joy that we have in looking at Our Lady's love and looking at the gifts of grace poured out on that life from the first moment of her conception, totally marked by the grace of God, in a similar way that we are marked by that grace when we are brought to baptism. The only difference between Mary and ourselves is the timing of that grace. We receive the same grace that she did at the first moment of her existence. We receive that at the moment of our baptism. And in the same way, with her assumption into heaven and her joining in the full integrity of body and soul to the life of God in his kingdom, which is a more accurate description, because for us heaven means something up in the clouds and far away, but rather to be present in the kingdom of God, body and soul, in the full integrity of her humanity, transformed by grace, which is also the gift to us. But we have the privilege, and the early church pronounced that privilege and proclaimed that privilege of seeing our future already present in what happened to Our Lady, in that grace that brings her into the kingdom of God, totally integrated, totally intact as an embraced human being. That too is our future, because it is already Mary's experience, and she is one of us. And another point I just want to highlight from today's readings, which is appropriate for us to meditate on. When Jeremiah sits in the mire, that's a lovely little bit of poetic translation there, when Jeremiah sits in the mire, nicer than saying Jeremiah sat in the slime. It just doesn't work out, does it? But anyway, when he was there at the bottom of this dryish water pit in the slimes and yuckiness that condensed there, who is it who comes to pull him out? Ebermelech, the Ethiopian, the African. Some translations even have Ebermelech the Cushite, which makes the point that he is from the southern parts, south of Egypt in Africa. And whenever we see personalities from Africa, and especially from the region south of Egypt, there's always this upheaval of Egypt, but even then, there is grace to be found in Egypt, if only the Egyptians of the modern age would wake up to that. Whenever Africa is mentioned, and when Africans are mentioned in the scriptures, whether it is here Ebermelech, or earlier the Queen of Sheba, herself was an Ethiopian, or somebody from Sudan, and also with Simon of Cyrene, also with the Ethiopian who was baptized by Philip, and various other characters from Cyrene and from Ethiopia in the Bible, they are always mentioned positively as those who search for God's truth, and for those who respond to God's truth. Egypt, that great ancient enemy of Israel, is the place which gives the Holy Family refuge when they have to flee the persecution of their own. Another point which Our Lady and Joseph experience these upheavals of faith that Jesus talks about in today's Gospel. And it is Africa who gives the Son of God refuge. It is Africa throughout the history of Scripture who recognizes the working of God. And it is Africa dedicated to seeking God's peace beyond these upheavals that we experience, that is described to us in Scripture. And so we who sit here at the southern point of Africa, in this church in Africa, need to take comfort that these upheavals that Jesus describes, in the same way that they were overturned to the transcendent joy of the Assumption in the life of Our Lady, will, by our searching for God's presence in our lives, bring grace and change to the world. Our example, our ministry, be it of prayer, be it of charity, or be it of simple fidelity to God and to our common worship, is an example that can draw the experience of the world beyond these turmoils that Jesus describes, and to the experience of that integrity and that love and that membership of the Kingdom of God, which Mary experiences already, which is our future, and it can be our present, if we reach out beyond our upheavals to embrace the gift of God, the gift of that Kingdom already present. Mary has joined that great cloud of witnesses of which our second reading speaks, as first and foremost among them, so that we might take comfort, knowing that beyond the upheavals which naturally occur in our lives, beyond the challenges to faith which cross our horizon from time to time, there is always the fulfillment of the Kingdom of God waiting to break through. As a teenager, she responded to the message of Gabriel saying, "Let it be as you have said." Just let it be. Let the Kingdom of God be. Let me measure my experience of exile, upheaval, and even the death of my son by God's promise and not by what I experience. And letting God's life be within her life and in her experience brings her to the full integrity of the Kingdom of God, which we celebrate as Christians, and which we rejoice in, because Mary, one like us, said, "Let it be." And the challenge is for us to constantly pray the same: "Let it be. Let the Kingdom of God be in our lives, in our prayer, and in our witness." Amen. We rise.